Let's go on the service tonight in the name of Jesus Christ. Let's stand and go to the Lord in prayer. That's God's blessing. Amen. Anybody else got a request?
Me.
I love the Lord.
I want to push the devil to die. I love the Lord. I love God.
Let's pray for Sister Lee Stanfield. Anybody else?
What were you saying?
Sister Marshall.
What's that? Where's my family?
Katie and Glenn. Evidently, God been dealing with them. Evidently, we still got to keep praying. Still got to keep doing it. And get to church somewhere to preach the truth. Won't it be wonderful there? Again for the opportunity we have to gather to worship, to give praise unto your name, thanking you, Lord, for salvation, for what you've done for us, thanking you again, Lord, for the blood that the Son of God shed on the cross of Calvary, thanking you for the baptism of the Holy Ghost. And God, we appreciate that among everything else that we can thank you for is our salvation. And Lord, we pray tonight that you will meet the needs, the petitions that we bring. We ask, God, that you'll move for Sister Lee Stanfield. We pray, Lord, that you will move for KD and Glenn. We ask God that you move for Becky's family and Ripley. Jesus, we pray again that you move in a special way and bless Sister Martha and help her, Lord, her situation. And we appreciate it, each and every one of us in this place, God. We come to sing songs of praise to the name of Jesus Christ the Lord. Amen. Number 57 in the blue book. Sweet by and by. Everybody sing. Ain't none of us experts, so we all sing together with sound. like we're not experts. There's a land that is fair and free, and my faith we can see it above. For the Father waits over the way to prepare us a dwelling place there. In the Hallelujah, hallelujah. Praise you, Lord, for the Holy Ghost. Number 46. Sing two verses of this one, then we'll. Number 1 and number 5. Number 46. Amazing Grace.
46.
Right across the page from me. One and five verses. People are saying the truth. The next big obstacle is living like Jesus showed it. Okay, everybody begin your song. Ready to get a song.
Hey,
that's the same.
Let me go.
Brown book,
David.
Red book,
please.
Huh? Look like it's brown, but probably red. I'm ready.
Y'all sing that together?
I'm going to sing by myself.
Okay.
I'll sing that later. Well, I want you to
sing. It don't matter. We'll just stand right here on this side. Yeah. Not back here. This is the Duck Trio. The one you want right there? He set me free.
He set me free.
Put it up here. Here, Rebecca.
Serving for Jesus. The only longing that I have is for thee.
Go down, go down, Sally, the good man.
time to give the Lord praise.
I love the Lord. I thank everything he's done for us.
Somebody else.
I love the Lord. I love God.
Well, Pharaoh's God. Sardis is located 40 miles east of Smyrna. Of course, you have to have a map, be looking at a map, and you can tell what's where that is. All of these cities in the book of Revelation are located real close to each other, of our, what we could term miles in our way. Sardis is 40 miles east of Smyrna, which we read about that, I believe, the chapter before. And Sardis was the ancient capital of Lydia. There was a country, three countries located in that region of Asia Minor in ancient days. One of them was Lydia. The city of Philadelphia was 30 miles southeast of Sardis, where it was located in that region of Asia Minor. And the city of Laodicea was a few miles, and the book that I got this from didn't give the exact number, a few miles west of Colossae. And it's located in Phrygia. That's another one of those. There was three countries located in, I believe, what's present-day Turkey or Asia Minor. In ancient days, what we call ancient days from our time. Laodicea was a few miles west of Colossae. And I believe there's a book written to the Colossians. I think it's the same city, I'm not sure. Okay, let's see what God had to say in this chapter here through Jesus Christ, the mediator. And unto the angel of the church in Sardis write, these things saith he that hath the seven spirits of God and the seven stars. I know thy works, that thou hast a name that thou livest and art dead. Be watchful and strengthen. Be watchful and strengthen the things which remain that are ready to die. For I have not found thy works perfect before God. Remember therefore how thou hast received and heard, and hold fast and repent. If therefore thou shalt not watch, I will come on thee as a thief, and thou shalt not know what hour I will come upon thee. Thou hast a few names, even in Sardis, which have not defiled their garments, and they shall walk with me in white, for they are worthy. He that overcometh, the same shall be clothed in white raiment, and I will not blot out his name out of the book of life, but I will confess his name before my Father and before his angels. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. Now what do we have listed here? I believe it's on the board down there. Four things about the city of Sardis that Jesus Christ spoke here. What were they? Number one thing was works. And we're going to notice this in a particularly this chapter, and we didn't notice it in the other ones. It was the same thing. The first thing that Jesus Christ notices about his people, because all these were churches and all these were born-again believers. The first thing that he mentioned in every statement just about was their works. And he always said, I know your works. To the city of Sardis, to the church in Sardis. Next thing was a name, a reputation of being a live church. But Jesus said, thou art dead. Boy, that fits some of them today. A reputation of being a live church. That's what he meant when he says, thou hast a name that thou livest and are dead. You are dead. A name, a reputation of being a live church, but art dead. The third thing Jesus said was their works not perfect. He notices that. Works are not perfect in this church. The fourth thing, they had a few godly members. A few. It's easy in going through these different churches, the different attributes about each and every one of them, we can see them around us in churches today, and if we're not careful, we see it in ourselves. First thing Jesus said, I know your works, those people in Sardis. I know the works that you're doing for me. And if he knows our works, then he knows when we're not works, when we don't have works. He notices that. Anybody that's trying to be saved and wants to live for God and plans on making it, which in a few short years from now Jesus will return because the things are winding up according to the things, signs that Jesus gave and the prophets gave, it won't be long Jesus is coming back. And surely anybody that's wanting to be a Christian and wants to be saved when that day comes are going to at least try to have some works of some kind. And they're supposed to be done in honor and glory of the Lord God. So number one was their works. I notice your works. You can see churches that has works. They do things. Now what is works? What is works? You don't invite people to church necessarily to get yourself salvation, do you? You don't do that. That don't get you the Holy Ghost, and that don't get you baptized. And you don't even have to be a repentant person to go invite somebody to church, but yet inviting people to church is considered works. And if you're not born again, And you can push the plate aside all day long unless you really want the Holy Ghost. You can be fasting. Now, I guess that could, in a certain sense, be considered works, but of course, fasting is a good thing because that helps bring a person into subjection to God. But in itself is works. You can write books, Christian literature. You can visit hospitals. You can do all of these things classified as works. Set up with a sick somewhere. Do good deeds all day long. Classified as works. Jesus said, I know your works. What did he say? I was in prison. You visited me not, or you did visit me rather. He named a list of things that classifies themselves as works. That don't save a person, but yet Jesus noticed the first thing about born again people is their works. When you're born again, you're not born again or saved. And you're not given the Holy Ghost to sit down, because Jesus said when after the Holy Ghost has come on you, you shall receive power to be my witnesses. And Jesus referred about these things concerning the works that the Christian people in the parables he spoke visited the sick, visited the jails, visited the prisons, communicated with people about salvation, done different things. Jesus said, I know your works. Many people have works, many churches have works. Some churches have a name or reputation, as this states here, like Sardis, of being a live church. Everybody says, we want a live church. I'm sure by this right here, he says, you have a name that you live. You get a name, or your name is published abroad, or your reputation is spread abroad by your attitude and actions, maybe. And concerning this church, you have a name that you live. So they had a name, and the Bible said here, Jesus said, they live that name. They had the reputation of that name. They were considered a live church for God. But Jesus turned right around and said, but you are dead. So what does that tell us? You can have the works. You can do a multiplied of things for the Lord. Be considered a live church. Whether it be in song, whether it be in worship. And yet he said, you're dead. Because that goes right back into what we've been teaching and preaching and believing, and which we're still hoping and want. And that is to get in that position where we can put on the very attributes of Jesus Christ and perform the things that he said we're supposed to be able to perform. That's when you're alive. That's when you're not dead. When you do the things that the book of Acts church done. The third thing he said to them, your works are not perfect. What works you've got is not perfect. You're doing it not with a whole heart. Your works are not perfect. And to the city of Sardis and that church there, you have a few, he didn't say a lot, a few godly members. So I know thy works, that thou hast a name, that thou livest and art dead. Be watchful. What's the commands he told them? He says, be watchful. Number two, strengthen the things that remain. What you have, God, strengthen it. You know, a lot of people, if they don't have everything that they believe, some people back up when they don't have the Holy Ghost, they just stop and they start going backwards instead of trying to push forward. They get tired of seeking. Some people have already got the Holy Ghost, certain things they reach for, they get tired, disgusted, and they freeze up, and then they start sliding backwards. Jesus told this church right here, be watchful. Strengthen the things that remain. What you have, God, strengthen it. Get a hold on it. The third thing, he says, remember your teaching. How do we know he says that? Remember therefore how thou hast received. How did they receive? Through teaching. Remember your teaching. Remember the scripture. Remember the word. Then he said, hold fast. When you hold fast, you don't let go. You hold on. And the fifth thing, after they've done all that, he says, then repent. And the other things slack up that you slacked up on, repent of it and get it in order. These things he commanded the Sardis church. Remember therefore how thou hast received and heard, and let and hold fast and repent, if therefore thou shalt not watch. I will come on thee as a thief. You shall not know what hour I will come upon you. Jesus can take us out of this world anytime he wants to. That's what he told them here. If you will not watch. Now you know how you watch. How do you watch? Through prayers. Mostly in prayer. That's the key. Fasting has something to do with it, but prayer is the main thing. Men ought always to pray. If you will not watch. And not only in prayer. When you watch, after you have left church, wherever you go, whatever you do, you remember the scriptures, you remember the teaching, you know what you're supposed to do, you know what you're not supposed to do. So you watch. You watch your life. You watch your words. You watch your actions of how you are presenting yourself to the world. You watch for your adversary, the devil, because the Bible says he come around seeking whom he made his whom he desires. How that scripture said. See, you watch it, because the devil will try to get advantage. Because we are in a war. The Bible says we are in a warfare. Spiritually. Now some people say demons don't exist no more, but friend, they're dead wrong. This world's got demons. And what makes you think, what do you think makes all them people do what they do when you see on the news of the killing and the robbery and the murder and all the other evil stuff that goes on? Where do you think this comes from? Demons. Fallen angels that have no hope. They're real beings. And they live in this world. The Bible said even Lucifer, Satan, is the God of this world. Not the Lord God, but God of this world, or ruler of this world. Paul said, we wrestle not with what? Flesh and blood, but with principalities and powers in high places. Referring to demons and however they manage things in this world we have to contend with. That's our warfare. So demons do exist. And almost the city of Sardis, about their reputation as a church being alive and are dead, fit just about every religion I know of in this town, including even ourselves, because of one thing. The church that's where it should be or supposed to be, and I can't nobody refute this from any denomination, not even Pentecostal churches, churches of Jesus Christ, any denomination you can think of. If they don't have the power and the ability to cast out real devils and to heal and deliver people, they are classified as the dead church that Jesus spoke of here. That fits anybody. He don't call it for nobody. And Hopkinsville and what, Bolivar, of course, both being people with mental problems, most of them, no doubt, and maybe all of them in this situation have demons, are demon possessed. Certain things may be classified as sickness, but some of it is demonic possession. I don't know how much is and how much is not. Some of it may be a physical thing, but still caused by the devil, regardless of what it is. Any kind of sickness or ailment is not of God anyway. And the church had what Jesus said they're supposed to have and were really a live church, they would deliver people and they wouldn't have to send them somewhere else to be locked up like that. But no churches has that power because they're not doing the one thing. Jesus is the key. He's the example. He fasted. He prayed. He prayed all night prayers. And the
Preachers that are being paid don't even do that. They sit home all the week long or run around. They do the works. I know your works. You've got a reputation. You visit everybody in the hospital. A lot of preachers got that reputation. They ride around, and when you know what they most of them do when they get through going to hospitals and places? They go about eating places and sitting there and eating and living. In other words, they're living it up. They're just riding around and living it up. But as far as getting in there and fasting and praying, and they're in church that's paying them money to do that.
Never do that.
But they've got a reputation of live church because somebody, boy, I like your preacher because he come by and visited me when I was sick. Well, did he deliver you? If he didn't have the power to deliver you, he may be a good man, but he still hadn't done what Jesus would have done. Jesus fasted. Jesus prayed. He prayed all night prayers. And how much does any ministers think they can get by with the same thing? And I'm particularly them that don't have to hold a job. I mean, there's a lot of them that these denominations pay their preachers good enough money, they don't have to hit like a snake. But they won't do what Jesus done. And then they try to teach the people, we ain't supposed to do that there today. It's a con game. The Bible says Satan has ministers like that. Okay, let's read on. If you won't watch, he said, I'll come on you as a thief. And you won't know what hour I'll come upon you. That means he'll take you out. That don't mean his second coming. You have a few names, even in Sardis. He said, even in Sardis. As bad as that church situation is in Sardis, you've got a few there that have not defiled their garments. They shall walk with me in white, for they are worthy. Now, every one of these people that walk with him in white are born again. They have the Holy Ghost, and they've been baptized in Jesus Christ's name. This whole, everybody in this church right here that he's writing to had this doctrine. Because Peter, Paul, and John, Ananias, and Philip, and all these ministers are the ones that preached to all these people. This wasn't the Trinity Church that he was writing this to. These people were baptized in Jesus' name, and some of them didn't make it. Because he said, you have a few that hadn't defiled their garments, and they'll walk with me in white. They're worthy. What about the others? There's some of them there that ain't going to get that privilege. Because you know why? They didn't do what he said. They're not watching. Are you watching? Or do you just forget the Bible when it's folded up and go home and do what you want to do? Routine daily life. No prayer.
That's the way the biggest part
no communication with God at all. And then you think you're going to be saved when it's over with. You're wrong. These right here didn't even make it. Jesus said, hell, you just got a few even in Sardis that's going to do this. You know the reason they're going to walk with me? What? They have not defiled their garments. He that overcometh shall be clothed in white raiment, and I will not blot out his name out of the book of life. And I've heard this two ways, and I'm not sure which way. One time I heard that every living being that God ever made has their name written down in a book. What that may be or may not be. But one thing is for sure, every born-again Christian, Holy Ghost-filled Christian that's been born again or in the salvation book, because some in the Old Testament, they had a different plan of salvation for that time era. The prophets, you know, back in the days of Israel and all that, they had to do certain things through the commandments and the laws and all that. And even they were in that book of life. But Jesus even said, you can get your name blotted out. He that overcometh, the same shall be clothed in white raiment, and I will not blot out his name. If you'll overcome, I won't blot your name out. In other words, when you get born again, you get that name at least in there then. And God watches your works because he said, I'm watching your works. And then, by the time it comes for you to die, if you're not in a position that God wants you in, Jesus, according to what he said, I can blot that name out. And you won't be in it. But once
he said,
I
will
confess his name before my Father and before his angels. Jesus did. Now, verse 7. And to the angel of the church in Philadelphia, write, these things saith he that is holy, he that is true, he that hath the key of David, he that openeth and no man shutteth, and shutteth and no man openeth. I know thy works. Behold, I have set before thee an open door, and no man can shut it, for thou hast a little strength. Can shut it. For thou hast a little strength, and hast kept my word, and hast not denied my name. Behold, I will make them of the synagogue of Satan, which say they are Jews and are not, but do lie. Behold, I will make them to come and worship before thy feet, and to know that I have loved thee. Because thou hast kept the word of my patience, I also will keep thee from the hour of temptation, which shall come upon all the world to try them that dwell upon the earth. Behold, I come quickly. Hold that fast which thou hast, that no man take thy crown. Him that overcometh will I make a pillar in the temple of my God, and he shall go no more out. And I will write upon him the name of my God and the name of the city of my God, which is New Jerusalem, which cometh down out of heaven from my God. And I will write upon him my new name. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. What about Philadelphia, the city of Philadelphia? And this ain't talking about Philadelphia, USA. This is over there in Asia Minor, or present-day Turkey, somewhere along in there, 30 miles southeast of Sardis. Now, when we say Sardis, I think of the back sky field. But that's not the Sardis we're talking about either. Four things about the church at Philadelphia. What was it? Number one was works. Second thing, he said, you have a little strength. The third thing, you've kept my word. He didn't say that about the city of Sardis, the church. But you've kept my word. The fourth thing, you've not denied my name. You've not denied my name. What about that city, the church there at Philadelphia? He said, I know your works. He said, I've set before you an open door. No man can shut that door. You have a little strength. We were in discussion at the factory, and you know one place Jesus said, I'm the door, and I can't quote the exact scripture in the gospel books, but where Jesus said something about his people know his voice, and they will find pasture, and they will go in and out and find pasture and rest and all that, and I went to me and Bledock was talking, and I said, I was just kidding around about that. And I said, well, I guess some people believe that going in and out, that they go on the outside and they come in and eat the pasture and, you know, God and the Word of God and everything. Then they go back out in the world, and the next thing you know, they come back in and eat like that. And I was kidding around about that. Of course, we don't believe in that kind of religion, but then we were just talking, maybe some people believe that. He said, probably it was the barn door is wide open. And they come in the barn in the time of a bad storm. And then when the storm's over, the barn door is open, they go back out in the pasture. And I said, I believe you're right on that right there. I said, I believe a lot of people get that confused about where they go in and out and find pasture. And he's got the storm comes along, they're out there in the pasture. And when the storm comes along, those that don't know any better, they have the pasture gate open and they go back out there in the world. And what he meant was they've got a barn door open over here where the storm will shelter them. And they could come into that till the storm passes, then go back out there and eat in the pasture. But what a lot of them do, when the storm comes, they go back out there in the world, then they come back in and eat the pasture when they're good times. They kind of, usually got like a yo-yo, you know, and they're not really sincere. But that's what he said, I said, before you open door, no man can shut it. You have a little strength. You have kept my word. You've not denied my name. You're not to deny. Somebody said, well, I don't see how any of them would have denied the name of Jesus Christ. I believe you deny the name when you don't accept any water baptism. Really do. To a certain extent. Because when you're baptized, what does the scripture say about baptism? What's it for? Acts 2:38. For the remission of sins. In another place in Acts 22, he said, rise and be baptized and wash away your sins. So it's for the forgiveness of sins or the remission of them. So, a lot of denominational standards of our day get their copy from Rome. The early church always baptized in the name of Jesus Christ to the Council of Nicaea thereabout when they made it a law, a canon law, the Roman church system. And then they started using titles, Father, Son, Holy Ghost. My Bible tells me that the devil trembles when you say the name Jesus. That's what it says, isn't it? When the name of Jesus is mentioned, the devils tremble. But they don't tremble when you say Father, Son, Holy Ghost. And all when demons are cast out, it's in the name Jesus, like Paul said, I adjure thee by the name of Jesus Christ, come out. That's what Paul done. He didn't say Father, Son, or Holy Ghost. And even in modern day churches of our time, most of them that don't even accept the name in baptism, when they pray over the food, they used to say in the name of Jesus Christ. Now they're trying to get so dignified, they just say, in the name of Christ. You are dignified. But a lot of them, though, everything they do, they'll do in the name of Jesus Christ, but when they take somebody's water to baptize them, and that's where your sins are remitted. The most important part, I mean, it's good to cast the devil out of somebody, but it's also good to get yourself saved. And to me, when you deny it in the baptism as well. Of course, there's other ways of denying the name of Jesus Christ. Bible says, whatsoever you do, in word or in deed, do all in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord Jesus Christ, giving honor and glory to the Father by Him. That's the way God wants it. So baptism is a deed that should be done in the name. Anyway, Apostle Jesus here, the Bible says he's an apostle in one place in Hebrews. He's the chief apostle. He made this statement here. You've kept my word, you have not denied my name. Verse 9, he said, I'll make them of the synagogue of Satan, which say they're Jews and are not. He said, they're lying. I'll make them come and worship before your feet. The Lord showed me a night vision one time of that church system doing me like that. This is where this comes from, right here. Along with the passage in the Old Testament. Trying to lead the people out of these denominations. And then the Lord showed me later on coming back and they were bowing at my feet. That's what He said He would make them do. Why did He say that? I will make them to come and worship before your feet and to know that I have loved you. The synagogue of Satan, or the church of Satan. And it ain't talking about demon worshipers, necessarily. It's talking about those that say they're Jews. There's people that say they're born again, they're not born again. That's what he's talking about. Apostle Paul in Romans chapter, I believe it's chapter 2 or 3, somewhere along there. A Jew is a Jew inwardly. Not outwardly in the flesh, but in the spirit. When you've been born again and got the Holy Ghost, Paul said in Ephesians 2, you are a citizen of the commonwealth of Israel. That makes you a spiritual Jew. Some say they're Jews and are not. Jesus said they're lying. They say they're saved. They say they're born again, but they don't have the Holy Ghost. They've never spoken tongues. They've never even been baptized in the name of Jesus to remit their sins, but they'll stand up and say, I'm saved. Jesus said, they say they're Jews, but they're lying. They're lying. He said, I'm going to make those people, because somebody's going to fulfill the scriptures. I'll make them come and worship at your feet. And for them to know that I loved you, because you know why he said, I'll let them know I loved you? There's a conflict with light and darkness. There's a conflict with truth and false. When the truth is here, and preachers are preaching the truth, there's a conflict with the other church if they don't preach the truth. There's a conflict. They don't like you. So Jesus said, I'm going to make them worship at your feet to let them know I love you. This is what he said. Because you have kept the word of my patience, you kept my word. You rejected Easter, you rejected Christmas, you rejected all the pagan holidays. You've kept my commandments. You walked in my commandments, you kept my word. I'll keep you. Ain't that what he done to Israel? There were Jews in Israel back in Ezekiel, Jeremiah's day. They were doing the same thing that has to do with Easter, except it wasn't called Easter then. They had doing the same thing that had to do with Christmas, except it wasn't called Christmas then. There was Israeli people that worshipped Tammuz. They cried real tears, thought they were worshiping God. They were sincere. But God spared them that rejected their way of worship. Those Israelis that rejected it, that were against it, against paganism, when the enemy came in and destroyed the city of Jerusalem, God spared. The others went down. During these last days in the end time, when the plagues are poured out, those people of the churches, and I don't just talk about denomination necessarily, but Jesus' name people, that are holding on to these pagan holidays and things like that, he said, if you partake of her sins, you are going to partake of her plague. Because you have kept the word of my patience, I also will keep you from the hour of temptation, which shall come upon all the world to try them that dwell upon the earth. Okay, let's look. Verse 14. And unto the angel of the church of the Laodiceans write, these things saith the Amen, the faithful and true witness, the beginning of the creation of God. I know thy works, that thou art neither cold nor hot. I would thou wert cold or hot. So then, because thou art lukewarm, and neither cold nor hot, I will spew thee out of my mouth. Because thou sayest, I'm rich, and increased with goods, and have need of nothing, and knowest not that thou art wretched and miserable and poor and blind and naked, I counsel thee to buy of me gold tried in the fire, that thou mayest be rich, and white raiment that thou mayest be clothed, that the shame of thy nakedness do not appear, and anoint thine eyes with as many as thou mayest see. I rebuke and chasten. Be zealous therefore and repent. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hear my voice and open the door, I will come into him and will sup with him and he with me. To him that overcometh will I grant to sit with me in my throne, even as I also overcame and am set down with my Father in his throne. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. The city of Laodicea was a few miles west of Colossae and was located in Phrygia. The five things that Jesus spoke about them, number one was what? Works. If he had something to say about us, he would mention what works are we doing. Are we doing any? Are you doing any? Are you trying to do any? works. If you don't know what works are, check in the Bible and see what he said do. Second thing he told them about them, they're not cold nor hot. The third thing, they were lukewarm and nauseating. The fourth thing, they were proud and self-satisfied. And the fifth thing, they were ignorant of their true state. I know thy works, that thou art neither cold nor hot. I would thou wert cold or hot. Jesus said, I wish you were cold or hot. I wish you was an all-out sinner or an all-out Christian. It's what he's saying. If you're an all-out Christian on fire, then he's very pleased. If you're cold as ice and in the world, even though you're lost, Jesus is saying, I can do something with you. I can deal with you to repent. But when you're lukewarm, you think you're in. I can't get you to repent because you think you already have. I can't get you to get on fire for God because you think you already are. So you're in a lukewarm state, Jesus said here. And because you are lukewarm, neither cold nor hot, I'll spew you out of my mouth. Nauseating. You ever took a drink of water and you thought you had some cold water and it was hot, or warm rather? We call it hot, just warm water. Real, real thirsty. Thought you were going to get a good cold drink of water and it was hot. Rather warm water. Lukewarm. The water wasn't really hot. It wasn't boiling, because what happens if you see steam rising out of water? You ain't going to put it in your mouth. Right? You know it's hot, hot. You don't put boiling water there because it's got steam and you know it's hot. Cold water, different. That lukewarm water, though, when you take a swig of that and it ain't right, you don't want to swallow too hot. So you just spit it out. And that's what Jesus is typing them lukewarm people with. Because you're lukewarm, I'll spew you out of my mouth. I'm going to reject you. And why? Because you say, I am rich and increased with goods and have need of nothing. Now he's writing this on church terms. You say you've got the goods. You say you're rich. You say you're saved. You say you're sanctified. You say you're saved. You say you increased with goods and have need of nothing. He said you don't even know that you're wretched. You're miserable. You're poor, blind, and naked. Miserable, right in the immediate state that you're not on fire, you don't feel the very glory of the Lord God or nothing like that, and your prayer life, you got it stagnated. And when you pray, you don't really feel nothing, but you keep trying to say, I know I'm saved, and most of these denominations try to tell you you're saved, so you go around and say, I'm saved, but you are miserable. How many times you see them, particularly in factories? You talk to most of them, they'll tell you they're saved, but you watch their life, they're miserable all day long, upset, frustrated, and some get to the point of using foul language. But later on, they'll tell you they're saved and want to talk Jesus with you. They're miserable like that. You can walk in the power of the Holy Ghost anywhere if you'll walk with Him. Jesus said to the lukewarm, I counsel you, I advise you to buy of me gold tried in the fire, See, now churches don't want fire. People in the world of denominations don't want the fire, the trial, the testing. But he said, I counsel you to do this. Because it will take away the bad that's in you and burn it out. If you let him. Now, he won't do it unless you let him. He's why he said, I counsel you to buy of me gold tried in the fire. You've got to let Jesus do this. When you go through the test, you've got to cooperate with him. And it don't feel good, but its purpose is there. It's burning out the bad. I count you to buy me gold tried in the fire that you may be rich. And white raiment that thou may be clothed. You know what white raiment was in the Bible and other chapters later on? The white linen was the righteousness of the saints. If you don't have righteousness, how can you be clothed? That thou may be clothed and that the shame of your nakedness do not appear. Anoint thine eyes with eye salve that thou mayst see. As many as I love, I rebuke, and I'll chasten. You know, when you rebuke a kid, what do? You're scolding them, right? No, you can't go with us. Social workers, they're off key with God's word anyway. But the Bible says scold them. The Bible even says whip them. Well, that's what Jesus does to his people. That's what he says here. As many as I love, I rebuke them. That's kind of like a scold. It's not something that you want. How does Jesus rebuke you? You ever think how he rebukes you? Now he said, as many as I love, I'll rebuke them. Have you ever been rebuked by Jesus Christ? It
makes you feel real bad.
And how do you know? How do you know when you've been rebuked? I mean, he says he does it, so how do we know when he's doing it? It's got to be that bad feeling that you just said. Something we have done wrong, and then we feel bad about it. It's the Holy Ghost quickening that to us. That's kind of like a scold. I'll rebuke and I'll chasten. And sometimes chastisement may come from, in one scripture, the Old Testament Psalms had to do what David said, chastise us with the stripes of men. We may suffer some type of punishment by the worldly people. That could be the chastisement. And we've got to take that. As many as I love, I rebuke and chasten. He said, be zealous, therefore, and repent. Don't be afraid to repent of something. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hear my voice, any human being, rather, it's referring to any human being. It said man means woman, anyone. If thou hear my voice and open the door, I will come into him. Now see, if Jesus ain't coming into your life, you ain't letting him in. If he don't come into your life somehow and communicate with you and live with you and talk with you, it's because you're not opening the door. You're not responding. You've got your ears tuned to something else out here. You've got your mind on something else. But you're not opening the door. For Jesus said, if any man will hear my voice, if any man will, when you hear my voice, the word of God, and you do what that word says, that's what you're hearing. And if you'll hear his voice and open the door, I'll come into him and will sup with him. That means fellowship. And he with me. And you'll feel good. You know why? It's the Spirit of the Holy Ghost. It's Jesus. What was in Jesus Christ, that Spirit. That was revealed through the Son of God. Jesus said it's not the Son, it's the Father revealed through him. It was God. And it's that fellowship with God, that's how it works. That's how we're made one with him. He fellowships us. And we can say we're not alone. To him that overcometh. So you got to go through that fire. You got to go through that cleansing, the process that Jesus put you through to get that bad out of you. Before a lot of people mess up, they try to look at other people's faults and make judgments and everything. That's why he said, judge not that you be not judged. It didn't mean you couldn't judge wrongdoings in the world. Some people got that so far off base of thinking he's supposed, if somebody out there murders somebody or like Hitler. There's about a 99.99.99% chance that Hitler's in hell. I don't think he made it no short time that he had left from the time they was coming in on him. And you can make the statement about Christ is in heaven, because we know what he is, and Hitler's in hell. And we just about make that statement and not ready to be judging. I mean, that's a matter of judgment. We're passing judgment. Some people say, well, you're not supposed to judge. That's not what he was referring to, judge not that you be not judged. He was talking about judging other Christians and trying to pick on their faults. Everybody that's in the church has got some kind of a fault that they ain't got ironed out. And that's where Jesus said he would work on us to get rid of the bad out of us. All we've got to do as individuals is cooperate with Jesus Christ through the Holy Ghost, work with him on cleansing us out. Everybody else in the church, leave us alone. Let us work our own salvation out with fear and trembling. It don't mean if we're a woman, or they can't hear the word of God and they're not supposed to cut their hair. That's not judging them. That's what it's talking about. Any woman living for God knows not to cut her hair. We're talking about other finer things down inside the being of the individual that Jesus has got to work on. And he gets this bad out of us. That's between us and the Lord by the Holy Ghost that works in us. To him that overcometh, when we overcome these problems, individuals, to him that overcometh will I grant to sit with me in my throne, even as I also overcame and am set down with my Father in his throne. Now, a lot of people, you want to discuss this, they say, Jesus is God because they have one throne and he's sitting on that throne. Now, he's the Father. But here, Jesus said right here, if you'll overcome, you can sit with me in my throne. How big is that throne? Is it talking about just a natural seat? Could you see everybody in the church, multi-millions of people in the world, throughout the ages of time, trying to sit down on that one seat, and Jesus sitting down there holding, maybe sitting on his lap? No, that ain't what he's talking about. No more than the Father sitting on that throne than Jesus sitting on top of the Father. He's on the same throne or side by side. That's not what he's talking about. That throne represents the power of the kingdom of God, the authority of the kingdom of God, rulers. And he didn't mean the Father didn't exist. He didn't mean the Son didn't exist. Jesus said, I overcame. He said, hey, I was down there one time. He said, even as I also overcame. Jesus was tempted by the same devil we are. Except he probably had that individual demon, Satan himself. Whereas we might have other angels that have fallen, bothering us. May not be specifically the devil personally. But he said, I overcame. Now, if I done it, you can do it. You can do it. He said, when I overcame, Jesus said, I overcame. You know what happened? I got to sit down with my Father in his throne. I now have been given power over all things. All things except the Father. That's Bible. But Jesus said, if you'll overcome, I'll let you sit down with my throne. I'll give you a kingdom just like my Father gave me a kingdom. That's why it's in Acts 2, what, 27? Even as I received of my Father. I'll give you a kingdom because he gave me a kingdom. Isaiah 53 said he poured out his soul to death, and God said, I will divide him a portion with the great, and he'll divide the spoil with the strong. That's what it's saying. Same thing. Jesus divided the spoil with the strong of the kingdom of God, and we will inherit and share that power and that glory of the kingdom just like he has received from God Almighty himself. And there ain't no difference in this. That Laodicean church was lukewarm. The one that started us had a reputation of being a live church. The one at Laodicea was just lukewarm and mellow. Kind of like these denominations. They're not really no fire in them. You see, some with the attributes of Sardis, they look like they're a lively church, but they don't have the power to heal a headache. Then you see other churches that look like the Laodicean church. They just sit back and they're just lukewarm and say, I'm saved. They raise their hand. They don't get excited. They never do feel the Holy Ghost because most of them don't even never even had it. But that church in Philadelphia, he said, you've kept my word and you're not denying my name. They were pretty strong and stable. Well, let's close out this portion of service. Let's all stand. That ends chapter 3. Sometime we'll go back to chapter 4. We'll eventually go through the whole book.
All can't stand. Most of them sleep.
Yeah, they're like all of them are. Does anybody have anything to say before we close? Let's keep praying that God give that power to heal. Sister Louise needs the healing, even though she done it. I don't mean she's out of it, according to what that doctor said. As far as they're concerned, she is. I mean, but it's a simple problem with God. And also God can heal everything else needs healing. God can do it. So let's be praying about that. We can't do it if he don't do it, but we can get him to do it. Praise the Lord. Anybody else got anything to say?